There is a consciousness and the mental concomitants or mental factors and then material. Body is the materiality, feelings, perceptions and the formations or preparations are known as mental factors and the consciousness is the mind. And the relationship between the mind and the mental factors are given as an example, just like a water body, a lake or a pond, and its waves. Waves are the mental factors, the whole water body is the mind. So without waves, it is difficult to understand the water body, and usually any water body always have some waves. So waves represent the main body, and main body manifest as the waves. That is how the mind and the mental factors or mental concomitants are happening. So mind is considered as the base, the original form, and from that only the thoughts are arising or mental factors are arising, such as feelings, perception, volitions and other mindfulness, desire, delusion, all are known as mental factors. So these are the relationship between mind and the mental factors. Consciousness is the water body. Mental factors such as feelings, perception, these are the waves.
Okay, so both the body.
You have to repeat. I didn't get catch the question properly.
Pass away.
Yeah.
Does the consciousness still there?
It's difficult because it is something really happening and we can't feel it subjectively. For example, you know the geckos, the small creatures right around there, when their tail is broken, it has some actions, but there is no mind over there. It's a kind of the actions are going on, and it is already recorded in there, but there is no monitoring mind as such. So likewise, after the body and the mind disintegrated, there may be some actions, may or may not be governed by the mind. There is some, after the mind leaves, the cooling down of the body, and sometimes some movements can happen, but that does not necessarily mean the consciousness must be there. There may be some actions involuntarily happening after the body, after the consciousness left the body. So therefore, you have to die and see. Theoretically, it says the consciousness leave the body at once, and thereafter there may be some changes in the body, sometimes movements, sometimes cooling down, swelling and all the kind of thing, they are not necessarily governed by a consciousness. Then if that is the case, it will lead to the death. It will lead to something like killing. So therefore, I don't know the medical science, medically what is happening. So you remove it either after a serious accident, definitely the person is dying. Under such circumstances, maybe, but normally, soon after the death, only the removal of the eye and all the kind of thing happen. The doctor has to make sure the patient has the consciousness has left the body, but still the worm and the heat and the body are all the things are available, and then you are removing it. You are removing it from a carcass rather than a living body, unless otherwise it's a severe accident. Necessarily nearing the death, well, before you can do it, and that is what we do. For example, we take the breath as a representative of the living body. The last drop of the living body is the breath. That's called in Sanskrit, it's called prana, ana, apana. It's a kind of a pana. Pana means the life. As far as the breath is there, the life is there. So what we do is, in the Anapanasati Bhavana, we focus the attention soon after the sleep sitting, where you find the gross breath. And if you manage to see the subtlety of the breath and go to the breath up to the uncertain, unperceivable level, it's a kind of, you are rehearsing the death. It's a not complete death, but there you are training yourself to see that the breath is becoming subtle and subtle and subtle. And when it becomes subtler, if you have the desire for the life, you have the desire for your body, if you desire for your all the other kind of thing, you can't let go. So if you have to let go the breath to the go to the subtle level, means that you are rehearsing kind of a cross, kind of a death. And then you are met up, met with feelings also. To let go feelings, you are kind of a welcoming a death, rehearsing a death. And then you have to let go of the perceptions, and again you are going to a deep layers, and ultimately you give up your volitions, you give up your will, you give up your motivations, and then let everything happen, autopiloting, and that is also kind of preparing another layer of death. And then only you can understand without the consciousness, or even I would say, without any manifestation of the consciousness, you can just let go. That is the way you are rehearsing the death. So this you can put it in another way. The Buddha mentioned, if you can see all the 11 facets of the breath, the materiality, or the 11 facets related with the feelings, 11 facets related with the perception, and the volitions, understood, that when mastered, he verbally or word by word, he advised his own son, the Venerable Rahula, "Oh Rahula, if you master 11 facets of the breath while you are living, I will assure you, your last breath also happen with mindfulness." So in each sitting, we are rehearsing to go to the very deepest layer. So at a time you go to the depth and again come back to the life. Again go to the depth and come back to the life. And that is how you prepare yourself for tsunami and any calamity in the world. So therefore such a person who has gone to very deep layers, he is not going abruptly. He go slowly, 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 slowly. And again come back. Next day he is going again. So likewise he understands that you can't go to deathlessness unless otherwise you experience the death. The deathlessness and the death is two sides of the same coin. If you have the fear for death, you will never do this experiment. Because you have your love for the body, the love for the life, and therefore halfway when the breath becomes subtle, you get up and open eyes and go for the forced breathing and all the kind of thing happen. So that means you are not generous towards your body and the life, so that you can go to the deep layers. If you are generous, if you have a good faith, and if you have good courage, and if you have good moral backing to go forward, and then you can go and experience the death under the light of mindfulness. So when I sit in 1979 in a retreat, the very first retreat I ever underwent, that was conducted by Munindraji, he is coming from India, and everything was in English medium. My English was not so good at that time, but anyway, he told before you experience the first Maggapala Jnana, you have to experience the death in your sitting, then only the Maggapala Jnana will happen. You are not experiencing it, that means your meditation is not mature enough. So that is how you are preparing yourself for the death. And the Buddha says, once you prepare for the death, you are ready for the deathlessness. Otherwise, you have something to compromise. So much so you are compromising, you will never experience the death. As far as you are not experiencing the death, you will never experience the deathlessness. Because they are the two sides of the same coin. So therefore this is becoming a yogi, becoming a meditator, practitioner means it's a huge, bold task. At the beginning you give up materialistic thing and give up the bodily parts, or give up your likings and dislikings and give up your personality. Ultimately you give up everything and prepare for the death. Then only you become reinforced, you become prepared and qualified to see through, and then only the deathlessness can happen. That is understanding of insight knowledges, going to the Maggajnana and Phalajnana can happen. Once you master this whole gamut of experience, from vivid living to the dead within a city. Are you ready? I correctly understood the question, but I will give a kind of an answer with it. You can see whether I have understood the question. There's one very famous teacher known as Deepak Chopra. So he is starting from the Hinduistic tradition, but he has fairly come to the mindfulness. He gives this way, he gives about the Hindu tradition. When someone is born in this life, he has already set the amount of longevity together with his birth. There's an account balance. You have 100 years to live, and you have 80 years, you have 60 years like. And he says, according to the Hindu tradition, the amount of longevity, the time is measured by the number of breaths. So he says, if you are giving 100 years, that means 2.5 million breaths in your account. I don't know the exact number, but he says exactly 2.5 billion breaths you have. So with that 2.5 billion, if you are going to do full tense life, full cholesterol, full of and heart attack and all the kind of, then you will you quickly expend it and die at 80s. But if you preserve that breath very calm and quiet, and then you will live instead 120 years. Because you are very concerned about each and every breath. You are not burning the candle from the both the ends, but still use the breath in a very calm and quiet way. So therefore, you have to concern about your each and every breath, whether you are bathing, whether you are eating, whether you are sitting, whether you are walking, whatever. But if you forego that and ultimately overspend it, or I mean rushing you to, ultimately you are going to have a premature death, at the deathbed only you come to know 2 breaths time, now I am going to die. And then what to do? There is no way you can do, because already you have spent in the bad way and now it is there. So he says, we are so unconcerned about our life, we don't know how many billions we have spent, how many billions left behind. And we are concerned about our children, we are concerned about the dollar fluctuation, we are concerned about the tsunami, we are concerned about all the kind of things, but we don't know our most essential thing. So therefore, whenever you breathe, be mindful. Whether you are nearing the death or whether you are halfway the death, you are starting of your life. So therefore, in short, mind your business. Oh, mind, be mindful. We have 1001 reasons to forget about the breath and run and chase behind this and that. Ultimately what happens is, you are burning the candle from the both ends, ultimately it's lost. But the nearing the death, you are asking, why don't you give me 2 more breaths or 2 more days? Oh, you are asking all the kind of things. But now, you're so unconcerned. So it's kind of a giving an alarm. Each and every breath is equally valid. As if that you had the deathbed. Then only you will understand the breath is the one counting at last, and you have already spent in a very consumerization way. And now at the end you are asking for 2 more extension and 2 more days extension. Why not you do it now? I don't know this the answer for your question.
It answered the question, so I'll try
with less amount of questions. Not very slow breathing it is asking. It's asking to be mindful of the breath. Because the breath is a kind of a calibration. It indicates your emotions. If you take a small gushing in, out, the slow in-breath and sudden out-breath, that's a very clear indication you are in a tension. If you have the equal in-breath and equal out-breath, that's you are very in a good health. If you have equal in-breath and equal pose, and equal out-breath and equal pose, that is the maximum you can do out of compassion to yourself. So these are the called pranayama exercises in Hinduism. But the Buddha never mentioned that kind of a controlling or manipulation of the breath. He says, whenever the breath becomes long, understand it's a long breath, in or out. Whenever it becomes short, be mindful it is a short. And that is the way you understand the breath represents your whole qualities, all the emotions, all your mind. The day you understand the whole the possible facets of the breath, you can say, where are we? Where are we heading? What is our mind set up? Do you need not to go to a psychiatrist or you go to this machine and that machine? By looking at the breath, you can speak. But towards that, to master each and every breath is not equal to the previous one. When you are in meditation, if you ask, how is your breath? It's okay, I can think face to face. It's happening after 5 minutes. No, it is the same. 10 minutes after, it's the same. That's what we usually say. But if you are clearly observing, one breath to one breath, there are different shapes and different manners and different things are there. So you have to be nice and discriminative to see the beginning, the middle and the end of the in-breath, beginning, the middle and the end of the out-breath to in-breath changes, out-breath to out-breath changes, that you can say that's the highest compassion, highest loving kindness you can do towards yourself. Time to come, but your emotions and your likings and dislikings, your personality traits will be little upset. Or they are asking to do this and that and all the kind of thing instead of observing the breath. So therefore this is the difference with the secular objectives and the spiritual objectives. So people, those who have a good value system and appreciation for their own well-being, they equally give the value for the secular life as reality or religious life at least 50%. But it's also, it is itself is an achievement. You can give a fair amount of time to observe the breath as if the most important thing. That does not indicate the breath is the only object of meditation. I mean, this is to exemplify, this is to give the value. The intrinsic nature of yourself may be representing by your breath or left leg and the right leg or rising and falling, whatever may be. You are nearing the breath or now fear is fear. It does the same harm even in the normal life or near the death.
Near the death.
Yeah. Why you are searching for near the death? Look at it now. No tension, you can just see it as an experiment. You are living now. Don't expect that you see that at the end moment, it is things are beyond your control and kind of thing. Knowing definitely you are going to die one day. Are you sure about that? It is not so, you can postpone. Otherwise, whenever the anger happens, whenever the fear happens, observe the beginning, the middle and the end now. Then only you can be prepared at least to see towards the end or control it now as well as the end. Or just you can see the nature of the fear, nature of the anger, nature of the desire, nature of the ignorance, everything. So therefore, deathbed is situation where mostly beyond your control. Of course, it is critical knowing that now is the time. That is why it says, if not now, when? If not here, where? If not you, who? It's a common for all good and the bad, everything. Now is the moment. Don't project it to the death just to make it just dramatic in thinking. But instead, make it the present moment. Then you are wise and well prepared for that kind of situation. Fear.
Yeah, fear.
Okay. That is true, but if you go unprepared, that is there. So therefore, best thing is to train yourself through the moral training, concentration training and the wisdom training. Because death is, every living being, death is a fear. in exception. Therefore, knowing that, now is the time for you to train. That is what we call, you have some compassion, you have some loving kindness to yourself, so you'll be prepared. The fear is Buddha refers the common name for defilements. Fear is the common name for the defilements. So as far as you have fear, that means you have defilements. So whenever you have no defilements, that means you don't feel any fear, you feel contentment. You feel brotherhood. You feel the protection. And therefore, the Nibbana is known as the deathless and the fearless. And the moment of mindfulness also has the same characteristic. Whenever you are mindful, you feel protected. You feel protected. And you feel enough. Enough is enough. So, momentum of the mindfulness is ultimately leading to the confirmation of the same and taking things under your control happen with the momentum of mindfulness. Deathbed, you being an attendant, if you can maintain calmness in your mind, that is the most proximate thing, best help for you can do to the patient. If you become agitated and moved, the patient will be the immediate person getting the shock. So therefore, when Freud is writing about this free association, the counseling, he says that the patient must have a very comfortable sofa to lie down, and then you as a professional assure that whatever you are going to say, I am not going to divulge it. So professionally, I am assuring you, please let your mind to talk. And so you have to give a number of days for the patients to come out, because even the patient do not know what is the root cause for this situation, the anxiety, the difficulty. So after a number of days, the patient by talking, by catharsis, go into the deep layers, and then the Sigmund Freud has mentioned, it seems, the best thing you can do as a counselor or the person who giving the free association is listen to the patient just like a dumb person, unmoved by his action, and completely calm down your mind. Then only the mind-to-mind telepathic can happen. If you are thinking about what he or she is talking and rationalizing, that means your mind is agitated, you will never grasp what is the best for the patient. Best thing is to calm down. And then mind-to-mind calm down happens. That is not you, but the professionally thing happens. So exactly, if someone is in an agitated situation or fearful situation at the deathbed, you as an attendant, the best thing is to calm down yourself. And that means this is something natural, and therefore nothing to worry. Thing will happen according to the law of nature, so we'll face it. But if you are going to agitate and all the kind of time, that is the worst thing you can do, worst thing you can add to the agitation of the sinking patient. But it's a task, so much so, all his, the Sigmund Freud's disciples denied, telling that how one can listen as a dumb person. But the Buddha has mentioned, the best yogi must see things as a blind. Even if you have eyes, see things as a blind, don't be angry. Listen things as a dumb person. Behaving as an idiot, you don't know anything, like anything happens, don't react. And that's the best you can do. That's the best in the meditation we do, non-reaction and unassuming, evenly suspended attention and suspended decision. Don't rush to a decision, and then only you get hooked up, you will get, you become answerable, that you can get the distance and still vigilantly, diligently, mindfully listen, observe everything, but get a distance. That's the maximum for the patient as well as for you. But it's a task. And this is well explained in the surgeries. The surgeon has to be clinically detached from the patient for a successful operation. If he is clinically attached to it, He will not be a professional surgeon. Therefore, surgeons are, I don't know, I heard, have their oaths. They must not go for their dear and near ones for operation. They have to give to another, assign to another fellow, the surgeon, because they will get afflicted during this relationship. So you have to get the distance. Otherwise, so it may be like the lack of compassion. It may be like callous. It may be like something. But it's something professional you have to develop. Basically about the generosity, people are usually poor, but whenever possible, they share as much as possible with for the constructing of a statue or giving some food for the monks or kind of thing. So each thing he write, date and thing, I offer this much of food for three bunch of monks, I offer this much of anapikara, all the kind of thing. At the deathbed, his mind still is not well anchored because he has done only generosity. Not much of moral training, not much of concentration training, not much of wisdom training. So therefore he asked at the deathbed knowingly, one of his elder children to come and read that book. So his mind is now always associating with the good thing he has done. So therefore, he can entertain his good, not let the mind to shift here and there. So very nice story is there. And you know, in Sri Lanka, historically, the King Duttagamini is one of the kings. He has built a lot of things, country under the sovereign ruling and all the kind of things. I think his brother, Saddhatisa, Tisa was the name, and even the Saddhatisa is a devoted king. And he has maintained his brother's this thing, and longest person he has ruled the country. And he has done a lot of construction and kind of thing. So, at the deathbed, one of his ministers has asked him, you have done so much of kingsly kind of meritorial deeds, what is the best now you remember towards your deathbed? Then he says, one day, king to be, and he has assigned some job, but he is not the full-fledged king. He has gone to a provincial area to calm down the riots over there, and on the way back, himself, the horse and the horse rider, the horse keeper, has to come across the forest. And the last rest house prepared the three packets, one for him and one for his servant who is taking care of the horse, and there are some other thing for the horse. And when they are going in the midday, now it is time for the meal, so his attendant came and asked, then now is the time for, why don't you go and have the lunch? Then he is opening the meal, he came to know, now each and every day, before I eat, I usually give some offering to the Buddha. But today in the midst of the forest, I don't have a chance to give something, to do some meal. You know, I am going to eat everything, it is not done. So he was so little upset, because it is not his way. So while he was thinking, there had been a very monk, an arahant, with full quality, so he can read the minds. So he had felt the king's necessity, so he has came in the magical powers and appear like a person, monk, meditating close by, and he appeared close by. So when the king is searching around, found there's a monk meditating. So he was so happy. And when they told Bhante, I never taken my meal before giving something. So therefore, why don't you take a little bit? Now it's the time for your meal also. He said, okay. He offered the bowl, empty bowl. Then the king gave little. And then monk told enough. Then the king has told, that I am so happy today. So therefore, I don't feel like eating. So why don't you take my whole meal? And then knowing that usually monkey is not taking the whole meal, because he also has to take it, but just take it. And then his attendant, who is taking care of the horse, see that his master is developing so much of quality, they are people, they never do this kind of thing. So he thought, today I also must practice it. And he has gone and asked the monk, one day that usually at home we don't have these kind of qualities or generosity. We eat whatever we eat, but I see master. So therefore, why don't you accept my thing also? So monks told, give me half. Then he told, no, take everything. And jokingly say, that person has gone to the horse and asked, you see the master. And you see what I did. What do you say? Then horse has told, yes. So he has given the meal for the horse also to the monk. And they all, the three, were so happy. So king, he became the king, and he did bit that is the biggest merit he remembered at the deathbed. More than all, and because he gave everything. And his servant also followed the suit. Even the horse followed the suit. So that is what he remembered. So these things are very common in Sri Lanka. So therefore people, whenever they do good meritorial deeds, they just try. It appears like boosting ego, but anyway, a kind of a humble way. They are not giving big things, but whatever they offer, they write it, and at the deathbed, they may be remembered. So they are not in the fear. Their mind is in the meritorial sphere, remembering one after the other what they have done. So it is a kind of a good day to face. This, of course, I would say, tell them before the death, at the deathbed, very difficult to understand.
When death is, that's what you mean, right?
Yeah.
Next minute, next moment, or next day.
The thing is, if you are going to put a caption in tomorrow's American newspaper telling everyone is going to die and all, and who are they going to read it? For the living people, death is something bad omen. They don't like to read. At the deathbed only they become burning and kind of thing. But they are very difficult for the first time to understand such a profound thing. But if it is possible, there is one book known as Where There Is No Doctor. That book has been translated into 50 languages by Warren or something like that. And he is giving remedies for all the diseases and accidents and kind of thing, little more than first aids, but not up to the doctor. It's a health servant's book. And a very nice book, very practical. At the end, he says, after doing everything, you will now come to know the patient is going to die. Under such circumstances, don't rush. Just share with him. Because he has undergone a number of things, so he may be ready now to accept the death, that you may be as a health servant agitating, so therefore accept the death. It is a kind of an end of the chapter, finished. And share with the patient. So if you have such a rapport, if you have such a connection, then you can share with the patient, tell him that you know now it is sinking and now come to the end. Why should we rush? Why should we entertain anxiety and depression? Accept it. But for that, the attendant also must have a very contented and well-trained mind. And the person who is in the deathbed also. And I would recommend you to read, there's a one series of book known as Chicken Soup series. Chicken Soup for Unregrettable Souls. That series is a number of issues written by a very nice writer. One book known as Chicken Soup for Unregrettable Souls. And it says that all over the world, under severe mishaps happen, how the mother look at the dying children, how the parents look at their younger children, how the younger children look at their parents' death, and they are how they dealt. And everything is appeasing, or when you are reading, these things are happening. Some people without any dhamma, any practice, they do the best. Some people, we are, of course, training ourselves, even then we may be a failure. But these books are really getting what is really happened, and it is opening eyes. Some has to instinctively do the best.
Yes. Said
11 touches. You have to come and listen to the Dhamma talk. That is why then you are coming on and off and asking me to repeat everything so you can listen to the talk. If anyone listening, listen, if they ask the question, I know it is my mistake, because I have to repeat it. But you are without listening, come in and ask, it is your mistake. Very good practical question. As far as you can keep the track with Anapanasati or mindfulness on the in-breath and out-breath, I would say without any metta bhavana, without any buddhanusati, without any maranaanusati, you can go. You feel you can't keep up with the mindfulness on the in-breath and out-breath, sometimes the desire arises again and again. So even if you get a chance, if you have a good meditation center and a fellow meditator, you go and meditate and again the desire comes. So there you have to read and understand your weakness or your diagnosis. Basic hindrance is the desire. Under such circumstances, you have to go and see if this is the medicine, this is what is the medicine. So that desire, if the desire is the medicine, this is medicine is the repulsivity of the body, the kayagata sati, asubha bhavana. Sometimes some people have the irritation, the friction and the anger. So even little bit of crack of the noise, they become angry. And even a mosquito comes, angry. And someone get up and go, become angry. If that is the case, he or she may come to know. Even though I know that I have to keep the track with the in-breath and out-breath, the little things make me angry. And therefore, anger is consuming me. Under such circumstances, leave aside the anapanasati and practice metta bhavana in order to alleviate that situation. If some younger generation and some people think, now I have practiced 1 hour, enough. I have enough time to live, so therefore next door also I will do 1 hour, 1 hour. So not necessary to increase, some people make excuses, I have enough time. Under such circumstances, it is a reminder death. Death, no one knows what time is going to happen. And sometimes you feel the flat battery. Battery is no energy, battery gone. I mean, no inspiration. Under such circumstances, recollection of the virtues of the Buddha. So therefore, these four guardian meditation has its own practical values. So usually, earlier, everyone to master little all the four before going into the main subject of Anapanasati. But living in household life, many find they don't have enough much time to complete all the four guardian meditation and then come to the Anapanasati and kind of thing. So therefore, the radical method is you just put on the Anapanasati. If it is going without the trouble, why not? But if it is troubled by hatred or desire or postponing or any lack of energy, then you have to understand. First and foremost thing is understanding and diagnosis of your character type and then compensate it. So therefore, when I go to Burma, my teacher Upandita, he says, these four guardian meditations are not medicine over the counter, they are prescription drugs. Someone has to prescribe you, you have the disease, do it. Otherwise, you go and consume it, just like over the counter, it won't work because it's maybe wastage of time. But after you mastering fair amount of Anapanasati, each and every master, you reinforce with you all the four guardian meditation in case you need or to teach someone. So when I was in Burma, after 2 years or so, Sahadu asked me, so now sit, meditate this metta bhavana for the sake of metta. Do asubha bhavana for the sake of asubha, because you must know it. But whenever, the group meditation happened, if you have a very short time, we just give a general prescription, the Anapanasati. If someone come and report, I can't meditate because it is because my hatred, then you have to stop it and prescribe, why don't you go and do little metta bhavana? If that is alleviating the problem, it is double fold results. Immediately after applying the metta, I can't go back to the Anapanasati or rising and falling and go. So therefore, this is a practical way in Sri Lanka and traditional countries. They are really appreciating these four guardian meditations. They have their own practical value due to the time aspect. And yet another example, another justification I can give. If you read the particular sutta known as Anapanasati Sutta, find in the Majjhima Nikaya, the Buddha ending a 3 months retreat, that means train retreat, and you find many people are really in a momentum. They are not finished, but it is catching. Then Buddha came to know, if I am going to declare the end of the training retreat, everyone pack and go start journey. So therefore their train will be disturbed. And therefore he says, even though rain retreat is finishing tomorrow, I am going to stay 1 month before, so why don't you continue like that? And under such circumstances, he see, this person is doing metta bhavana, this person is doing maya buddhanusati, this person is doing asubhasati, this person is doing all the kind of things, and for all, Buddha prescribe anapanasati. So that means it's a kind of a comprehensive kind of meditation. If the anapanasati is working, that means you can do away with others. But mind you, if it is not working, you must be really scrutinized what is the causative factor, what is the diagnosis, and then accordingly you have to go and do compensation with the what you call guided meditation. But if you are a person going to share with others, or they are going to take care about others, you must be mastered in all the four to use whenever it is necessary. So therefore it is a adornment, it's a kind of a additional quality in the Theravada tradition. This all for a guardian meditation, so you can use it when that they are necessary in the practical way. But in Sri Lanka, before the 1956, that Buddha Jayanti, there were no direct stream meditation like Anapanasati or my rising and falling, anything. They were doing only the four guardian meditation and finish. But nowadays it has gone another way. Whenever they have the time, they try either rising and falling or Anapanasati or walking, knowing if this is not going to work, we have to go back and consult the four guardian meditation. So I think this is because nowadays meditation is basically with the lay people rather than monks. If you are in the forest dwelling monk, you must know all the four guardian meditation and Anapanasati because you are full time. But the lay people, they go for the mainstream first.
I'm the gentleman who wants to be, you know, as now.
Difficult to make a generalized or general conclusion. Your situations are very multivarious. So, I don't know what is the meaning of meditation you mean. If you take the mindfulness as such, to even the spiritual life you are going to define with the mindfulness, the hindrance coming from the relative itself is an object of meditation. Then still under the obligation you can do, you are fulfilling, telling that under the present situation, socially obligations are there, politically and kind of thing. So he perform it. No, I mean, this is not the best, but this is what happens. So you have to do. So, if the whole life is going to consume on this obligation, I mean, it's unfair and no advantage, but that is not the case. If you are fulfilling duties and knowing this is what, right? This is a hindrance. So, it's a very good chance to understand what does it mean by the hindrance. And whenever getting a chance, I mean, the duties are fairly fulfilled and they are well off, they can do their own thing, then you will be really understand the value of such a release, because you are so far engaged in fulfilling the duties. So in my case also, I had basically the father was ill and I was fully attending. Of course, that was not that I can't say before that I had any idea about renunciation. No, I was not aware about any mindfulness. And after that, he passed away. It's a huge blank, huge gap. Then I don't, it is the life. Well, my virtuous person. And I see the suffering at the deathbed, and everything is gone and finished. By that time, I have broken all the five precepts. I was a robust young man behind pleasure, and I told her, if I am going to die, it will be 10 times more than that, because I have inflicted suffering for others in such a pursuit of pleasure. So then I told her, he did the life. So I told then no use of learning, no use of gain anything, because I see at the deathbed. And then make me some kind of a vacuum. Then only that another man told, be the life as it is, you be mindful. Don't try to be spiritual. Don't go rushing to the precepts. Just be my 8 years for me. You won't believe I am very inefficient. Very, very inefficient to understand the meaning of mindfulness. And then onward, everything going to start in a very nice combination. And then I came to know, oh, this is high time to renunciate. Then I would have been, had I been in the lay life, I would have been 200% successful. When there is a kind of a intrinsic knowledge came, now things are good, say bye-bye, get out. And before that, it was a hard task. Because you are not qualified, mindfulness is not up to that, not enough money, pressure, and all the kind of that. What to do? You keep on doing. No one knows that what you are doing. But in my case, I was just earning the meaning of mindfulness under different circumstances. Sometimes I read. Sometimes I do bad things, try to do bad thing with mindfulness, try to do good thing with mindfulness, try to be a bad man in out external life, and try to be good man in the secret life, all the kind of thing. So therefore the best outcome is, I can sympathize any person now. Any bad person I can understand because I have done all the bad things. It never disqualified me to be mindful. Mind you that all the bad things you have done never do any permanent harm to your mind. It's completely fresh. You can be fresh to the next moment. Don't worry about what you have done. That is the worst thing. I am not telling callous, I am not going escaping, but I am telling the mindfulness is such a thing. It never despite you. Mindfulness will never despite you, even you despite the mindfulness. Have that will, and our past karma, our liking and disliking, our personal traits, everything will come and give the challenge. Face it. Ultimately, you get calm after the storm. The big storm comes, that is huge calm is behind. Be ready to opportunities. Be opportunities at that time. Don't throw parties and go for carnivals. They say goodbye and get out. You see, it is a task. So therefore, these people are escaping people. I complain them. They are taking this as an escapism. Mindfulness will never give any chance for escapism. You just face it. That if such a grave thing happens, if you are mindful, you see your capacity, huge capacity. Enormous capacity to help people. No end. If you are going to limit yourself unmindfully, then only you say, I can do only this much and then I will be exhausted. But when you are going to perform mindfully, huge amount of energy. Time-wise, the energy-wise, and the strategy-wise, and the renovation of your qualities, endless. You can't say that Buddhism is 2600 old. It is so fresh. It is here and now. Don't take spirituality. Don't take concentration. Don't take merit. Don't take anything. Take only the mindfulness. That is my way. Only the mindfulness. And then mindfulness will take care of everything. There is nothing that mindfulness can't penetrate it. That's ambrosia to everything. And at the beginning you are very slow. I mean, it's gathering the moment in a very painfully slow manner. And unduly, once it gathered, you are not the one when it's coming to the moment. The mindfulness takes the help. Different or question or what?
The question is...
I mean, that do you think it is that your active life and the mindfulness contradictory? The question I can ask. Are you aware that you are not mindful at some times? Who knows that unmindfulness? Who knows? That is the mindfulness. In the mindfulness, I am telling you. Now mindfulness is taking care, not only the mindfulness, it is taking care of the unmindfulness also. That is the blessing. So unless otherwise you introduce the mindfulness, you can't make that statement. Because now you know at that time I am not mindful. What a beautiful. Never mind, even after or before, you come to know I am not mindful. I mean, who corrected you? Who diagnosed you? So that is the only thing you earn for your whole life. This is the most precious thing you earn in your life. Ask someone, can someone rob this quality from you? Can you erase from that this quality from you? Never. No, it's permanent. Whenever you become unmindful, you come to know. Play hell, no problem. Play as you like, play as the life comes. But let the mindfulness shed the light. And then you know this is good, this is not, they are mindful, they are not. In front of him, I am mindful. In front of him, I am not mindful. When I am eating that food, I am not mindful. When I am eating that, I am mindful. And the whole life will be bookkeeping. It's the best you can do for your health. This is the most compassion you can do it yourself. Who the hell can eat for you? No one. Therefore, the bookkeeping is there. So therefore, any time you can see the balance, whether you are gaining or lost. So far, you have not even introduced the mindfulness into your life. So whatever the gain, whatever the lost, it's an utter lost. Oh, the moment you come to know the unmindfulness, throw a party. It's a hilarious thing. It's a hilarious thing. So that's the only thing we earn in this life. It is not given by our parents, it is not given by the God, it is not by your prayer. Prayer is by your trial and error method. And believe it, that will never despite you. No one can rob it from you. Even you can't erase it from you. Now get the chance to give the chance to the mindfulness. Oh, okay, you take the help. I will perform in the normal way. And ultimately mindfulness will cut off all the inefficient parts. And it will lead you slowly, slowly to the efficient ways. It is happening in a very harmonious way. It is happening in a very natural, beautiful way. And there you can see the life is completely aesthetic. Something like a flower blooming. Or sun is rising. Because you are not manipulating, only the mindfulness is manipulating. You sympathize. You sympathize any mistake you have done, and then only then you can sympathize another person. The day you sympathize yourself, you know why other people are not, they are not mindful, they have no accounts book, they have no bookkeeping, so what to do? So they have the mindfulness, what I say is, it never restricts you. It rather opens you. But at the beginning, you restrict yourself in order to facilitate the mindfulness. We call moral restraintment, the concentration restraintment. But when you come to the wisdom, it's an utter open. Now already 1 hour we have taken. 30 we will be doing walking meditation, 2:30, 3:30 sitting. Hoping there are no more questions today.